So we left out part of the story of the Ice Age floods, and so I'm going to dive back into that real quick. So we got some more Ice Age tale to tell. The Bonneville floods, which came from, you know, Utah, Idaho, blasted through here, through the Snake River, made a canyon so deep that Evel Knievel couldn't jump it, and moseyed its way all the way to the Tri-Cities. Snake River flows in here. Now, you might think, yeah, a big flood can just catch the Columbia and get on down the line. Not so. Remember the Wallula Gap? We flooded backwards during the Bonneville flood. So that wash came in and came this way. It happened during the Ice Age floods, right in the middle of them. And it was a doozy. I think that there's only one known Missoula flood that was bigger than the Bonneville flood, but otherwise the Bonneville was a big baddie that came through. It also brought lots of pink rocks here, orangey pink rocks, whole different basalt layer that it was kicking up and sending over, different color rocks. So the inflow coming in off the Snake River just filled this whole basin and backed it up long ways, lots of water. And the Columbia River Gorge got gorged some more. There are some signs of life after the Ice Age flood, and that would be finds that they found in Umatilla, Oregon, which is just south of here, on the Columbia River. They built a dam, 60s, maybe 50s, I don't know. And they had to move the town, little town of Umatilla, they had to move it because the dam was going to flood where their town was. So they excavated and built a new town. Well, within the old town of Umatilla sits remains that are 11,000 years old. While they were tearing up houses and stuff, they found all these artifacts. So that area was populated right at the end of the Ice Age floods. You know, because of the floods that came through here, you had a lot of fresh water and ocean water mixing up, and the salmon thrive in that. Not only that, they could get so far upstream now. The Kennewick man was found right down there on the Columbia River. Some kids were sneaking into the boat races via the Columbia River. One of them kicked over a skull, and there it was, the Kennewick man from, you know, 8,000 years ago. They found a whole toolkit with him. He had a spear. He had a spear shot in his side. It's quite a story that Kennewick man is. Another piece of evidence of life is down at Coyote Canyon, which is down the road there a little bit, 10 miles maybe. Woolly mammoth remains. So that woolly mammoth didn't die here, it washed up here. You know, the native population that was here, and there's a big story to tell there, and we'll get to that. Today, we're gonna talk about houses that were built here in the 40s and 50s, and we're gonna look at the different styles of houses that the government built, and then we'll look at some styles of houses that people built. The ultimate goal after that is to find out, why did they build these houses? What was so important here that they had to build a bunch of houses in a scabby, sandy, windy desert? We get about 10 inches of rain a year here, and at the end of this lava flow, the ancient lava flow 150 million years ago in Oregon and Washington on the coast, they get 100 plus inches of rain a year. So there we go, that brings us up to date. Let's go to 1940. We're gonna look at houses and different styles of houses. First houses that came in were prefabricated. I think they were in Spokane, and they sent them down rail and then assembled them here in Richland. And then they started building alphabet homes. These were lettered homes. They had a different letter for each home model. They had no rain gutters. They were very cute little houses that they built for more long-term residents. See, the prefab homes that they put in here were only meant for, you know, 10 years of use. They were 2x2 construction. They were basically tents, pretty much. And it's interesting how many of those have been updated, moved around, and people live in them. So one of the draws to this area, courtesy of the Ice Age floods and the ice formations grinding back and forth and tearing up mountains and ancient volcanoes and creating a loess, which is a nice, powdery, rocky soil that's perfect to grow in as long as you can get water to it. You had loose in every direction. Now the wind blows like hell here. It really does on a regular basis. And then you had more flooding, so that loose got scattered into areas and it kind of flattened out, and it created some perfect little farmland for people to work the land. We had earthquakes, a couple big ones, massive superquakes, shook everything, dropped elevations 20 feet. Huge earthquakes came through here in that time span of the Ice Age floods, after the Ice Age floods and during and before. We also had super volcanoes that went off. And then we also had regular volcanoes that went off. You know, Mount St. Helens was active, and Mount Hood, and all those big mountains were blowing out shit at that point. So you can't really call Richland a boom town because nobody got rich. These were all workers that were here for a particular reason, and Department of Defense, the Department of Energy, and the Atomic Energy Commission, and DuPont, and you know, every big company in between had a piece of this thing. They needed people. They needed a lot of them. We're going to do another episode and talk all about that, but right now I just want to focus on where they put the people and the styles of houses that they put them in.
Where's his Sunday best? Mother's tired, she needs a rest. The kids are playing up downstairs. Sister's sighing in her sleep. Brother's got a date to keep, he can't hang around. And it's usually quite loud. Our mum, she's so house proud. Nothing ever slows her down, and a mess is not allowed. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our street. Our house, in the middle of our street.
Something tells you that you've got to move
in the middle of our.
Father gets up late for work. Mother has to iron his shirt, then she sends the kids to school. Sees them off with a small kiss. She's the one they're going to miss in lots of ways.
There's our neighborhood. In that neighborhood, we have a mixture of alphabet houses and the prefab houses. We also have prefab houses that are pushed up against and part of alphabet houses. So, you know, there was a big scramble in housing. Finding people a place to live was a real problem here in the desert. They did pretty well, though. And who would have thought these things would still be here? But you know, there isn't that much rain. There's nothing but wind here. That's really what you got to protect. And you know, I think these trees helped. And I think the design of the houses, not having eaves or rain gutters, made it pretty wind resistant. They were repaired, they were taken care of. It was government housing. Now it's all privately owned. So there we sat for a lot of years without any neighbors, and then these guys moved in. I call this the Brady Bunch neighborhood because the houses were all built in the 60s and 70s. The reason it took so long for there to be houses out here is that there was an air raid siren.
Mother's tired, she needs a rest. The kids are playing up downstairs. Sister's sighing in her sleep. Brother's got a night to keep, he can't hang around.
Just so you know, I didn't take all these photos today. A lot of them I've taken earlier. And of course, some of them are older than I am, so I didn't take those either. Thanks for coming to Pics by Dan. We got a lot more story to go. This is just a piece. Next episode, we're gonna look at the native populations and take a look at them and see how all of this affected them. We're also gonna look at the farmers that were here in the early 1900s and who all of a sudden found themselves homeless along with the Wanapum Indians. We're gonna tell that story next time. Hey, thanks so much for coming to Pics by Dan. Hope you have a great day.